Arthur started out as a television art director for ABC, and he met Jules through one of their advertising agencies and decided to start their own company.
I knew a little about it. George Powell in Czechoslovakia did a series of shorts many years ago called Puppet Tunes. So when I saw one of these studios in Japan doing something similar, I wondered how we could make it more acceptable to an international audience. You know, we got lucky. We did Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the first of its kind ever done and seen as widely. It was a wild success. First opening, I mean, it had 50, in those days, the way they counted audiences, only the networks, right? We had 50% of all the viewing audience in the first time out. Well, then everybody called up and said, could we have one of those?
If I must say so myself, you are a masterpiece.
Why, Dr. Frankenstein.
When they did Mad Monster Party, they got Jack Davis, who's my favorite artist of all time. It's like everything came together in 1964 for them. Not only was Rudolph a smash hit, but they locked into like these really great artistic people at that time too. Maury Laws, all their designers, the voice actors. Don Duga was an artist out of New York, worked on a lot of different animated projects, and his job was to translate the script into a visual format, which was a storyboard.
Which is my most favorite thing to do in a film, because that's where you create the thing. That's where you do the cinematography, that's where you take the angle shot, that's where you put the key poses in for the animators to animate to. So, which are critical to the whole film. One of the things is that, you know, timing and staging is one of the things that, you know, we know in animation. And when you're boarding it, you try to pace it so that the sequence where the vampire is trying to get him in his teeth, and just at the right moment, he bends over because he's doing, you know, I gave him a little gesture here, dropped his glasses, he's picking up his glasses, boom. Just at that moment, he stumps and hits a tree and that kind of thing. So there was all that kind of timing stages of the thing, which were kind of fun to do. And the sequence with the gorilla in this sequence here, like this is a shot where they are looking frightened and he on the other side is holding up this test tube. And he thinks, oh, it's this test tube that they're frightened of. But when you, and I cut to the other angle, you see it's a gorilla that's behind him that they're frightened. It's a funny mix of the scene because, you know, he thinks, oh, he's empowered, and you cut back to him, and it gave me a chance to do these kind of gestures. He's feeling really strong, you know, Felix Blanken, oh, wow, I'm big, you know, I'm strong. Look at those people, they're frightened of me. Mm-hmm. That kind of thing. So those are fun scenes, yeah.
Hi, ho there. May I get you a banana?
Storyboards were done and they were sent out to the Japanese animators.
Fortunately, even more fortunately, I found a source of animation in Japan at the very beginning in stop motion, which we refined and called Animagic, and whereupon we had, I guess you can call them dolls, built with a full human armature and moved them one frame at a time. And as many casts, as many figures, dolls, if you will, on the set, there was a live person in back of the camera. We didn't do this by computers or by charts. It was all by memory. So the actor remembered every movement the character was making. And after the frame was clicked over, the actor, the human, would jump in, make his next move, and jump back again. And of course, that went on and on and on until we finished. We worked all night because you couldn't say, now we're going home. Remember what you did tomorrow. So until there was a cut or a break, we kept going. And Mad Monster Party was made that way.
The animators in Japan were in a studio called MOM. And the top animators, the top stop motion animators of Japan. Each puppet would cost around $5,000 to make. And nowadays, like with the Tim Burton films, they would make several characters of the same character so that they can shoot them on different sets.
You had a team would go on wig makers and costume makers, and you know, making a lace dress fit somebody that big is a good trick. But they knew how to make small fabrics. Now, just like you would make Levi's, we wanted Levi's that big to look exactly like Levi's, for example. So they could do that in the studio. It was a world. It was just a whole world in there. You walk in, it's just like you're in a major studio, you know, with big sets, only they're small.
It wasn't just a real simple type puppet. It was very complex. And to change the mouths and the eyes and do all that stuff that they were doing was pretty amazing, you know, that they were able to get that kind of animation done in the 60s, you know. Nowadays it's computer assisted, so it's a lot more refined. These guys were like pioneers, you know. They really developed something that was unique and had never been done before.
Well, it was hard work, I can tell you that. It was, as I said, we worked, if we had a scene going, no matter how many characters were in it, and in some scenes we had two characters, or even one, just one for close-up face dialogue. In other scenes, and there's a party scene here in the book, I can't count how many characters are here quickly, but it must be at least 30. And 30 people were working on that scene. We didn't stop until we finished it. Because how could you possibly remember the next morning where you were the night before if you didn't continue quickly? I lived in Japan for many years and would be in the studio and costuming the figures, which is a strange thing for a grown man to be doing, I know, but but in Mad Monster Party, I picked out Jessica the costume. That was my favorite character. She was a tough kid to work with.
What Rankin Bass did that no other stop-motion animation studio ever did was brought personality to stop-motion. You know, when you look at a Rankin Bass show like Mad Monster Party or Rudolph, you don't think of them as puppets. You think of them as characters that live and breathe and have a personality.
Felix Flanken.
This Flinkin, Flunky, whatever he calls himself. What kind of a monster is he? A ghoul? A demon? A spook? Or a
human?
They're the worst kind. He must be done away with.
All of the monsters and all of the men characters in the movie were voiced by one guy, Alan Swift, who's one of the greatest New York voice actors ever. He did a lot of the Howdy Doody voices, like Mr. Bluster, and he even did Howdy Doody for a time.
I started as a stand-up comedian until I auditioned for the Howdy Doody show. And when I got that, I said to myself, "Ooh, I'm going to make myself a king of this business, because doing voices is the easiest thing I do in my life. The idea of being paid for this, I mean, I used to do it all the time with my friends as a kid. I would tell them a movie. They would all sit around, they would say, all right, tell us a movie. And I'd tell them a movie, I'd do all the characters' voices.
What he did was he created these characters based off of famous movie actors. Like Felix Flanken has a Jimmy Stewart type voice.
Well, there was Lincoln in Washington looking down on me, and I thought, wow.
The Invisible Man was Sidney Greenstreet from like the Maltese Falcon. Yetch was Peter Lorre.
Peter Lorre was no problem at all.
We'd go to a studio to do a track, and I'd have some people with me or working for me. I would say, let's do Wallace Beery. Who? Wallace Beery. No, nobody knew who Wallace Beery is. Do you know who Wallace Beery is? No one knew who Wallace Beery was except Alan. I'll do it. And he steps over, and he does it. You know, boom. Well, not let me try it. He does it. He's right on. And he could do that with voices.
Lunch, anyone?
Arthur Rankin told me that the middle section with the chef and the airplanes and the skeletons were put into the script to flesh it out because Joseph E. Levine wanted it to be longer. So that wasn't even part of the original script or the original film, and Arthur thought it was too long.
Pick me into the air, zombie birdman.
I remember some lines that are my lines. He takes Francesca to they're searching down their uncle, and they're in the jungle, and it's very dangerous there and so forth. And he says, I have to go back and get something, and I'll be right back. He said,
go on without me, Felix. Just leave me something to read.
I like the combination of the wimpy Felix and the beautiful Francesca. I thought that was such a great combination in their interaction. So those were I like those scenes a lot because they played with contrast a lot.
Dracula is interesting too because Jack Davis's Dracula, which you can see in the movie with the monocle, that's basically what became the Jim Henson Count character. That was developed straight from Jack Davis's version of Dracula.
Oh, you gorgeous, tantalizing creation!
I think when they got Phyllis Diller and Boris Karloff, that was intended to make it a large budget film. So getting Phyllis Diller and Boris Karloff right off the bat was marquee smart, you know? And I think they did decide to call Frankenstein's Monster Fang because of Phyllis Diller being in the movie and making her the monster's mate, which was perfect because she has that hair and that outfit that sort of the monster's mate or the bride of Frankenstein, you know, right off the bat.
Well, Phyllis Diller that you know or knew from her performances is exactly what she is. Phyllis is straight out, up and down, and funny. And that was the character I caught in Animagic, too. She played herself.
The closest thing to Rankin-Bass now is Pixar, and it's because they go through several drafts of script. They write these things with heart and warmth and to really appeal not only to kids but to adults and everybody in the world. And they credit Rankin-Bass for that, you know? They all grew up on this stuff. It's real important to have that heart and warmth. Without that, you don't have something that will last, you know? And that's what people always ask. Well, how did these last for 40 years? You know, why are we still talking about this stuff? Why do people care about Rankin-Bass anymore? It all comes down to the core. It had that heart and warmth that will live on forever.